Maybe it's not your plot that's pissing you off. Maybe it's your characters. Hey guys, I'm Michelle. Welcome back to my channel. If writing workshops and traditional publishing talk are your thing, please consider subscribing. So today's video is the second in a new series that I'm trying out this year. If you missed the first one, this is why you won't write a book in 2021. I'll link that up here in the cards. In this video, I want to talk about why your plot is pissing you off. If you've watched any of my videos before, you've probably heard me talk about how much I love plotting. And I do, but that doesn't mean that my plots don't give me a hard time. Because they do. A lot. In fact, if I'm being honest, making videos like this, it's always a little bit self-serving. Because while I really do want to help you with your plot, talking through all of these issues really helps me out with my own too. A few weeks ago, I used my community tab to ask you guys what is bothering you about your plots right now. And all of the responses I got had me nodding my head and thinking, yeah, I have been there. I'm really hoping this video addresses everything you guys asked. And if you came to this video looking for help with a specific plot problem, check the description below for timestamps. The inciting incident isn't life-changing enough. This one is tough because sometimes you're really, really far into the draft before you can even identify this as a plot problem. The inciting incident might be obviously life-changing the moment it happens. The main character knows in that instant that his life has just been irreversibly changed. But it may not seem like that. He might not fully understand until later that there's no going back. It might take the protagonist most of the journey to realize there is no going home, maybe in the physical sense or the emotional sense or both. But in either case, whether the main character realizes it or not in that moment, there is no going back for them. So ask yourself this, how would you write your main character sidestepping the inciting incident and going on with her normal life? Really look at it from all possible angles and try to find a way. Or put yourself in her shoes and ask yourself, what would you do if this happened to you? If you were in a bathroom during an office holiday party when terrorists took everyone hostage. If a tornado ripped you and your whole house from your farm and smacked you down somewhere that was definitely not Kansas. If you were just trying to relax with your family when intruders broke into your vacation home and turned out to be your evil doppelgangers. Can you find a way around it? Can you figure out a way to avoid confronting this thing? The closer you can get to the answer being no, there is literally no way I can ever go back to my normal life after this, the bigger and more life-changing your inciting incident will be. The stakes aren't high enough or feel irrelevant. My first thought here was to talk about how not all stories are high stakes, and that's okay. Not every story needs to be about one man taking down a bunch of terrorists, or trying to figure out how to get home when you're stuck in a weird world with flying monkeys, or trying to figure out what the hell your doppelganger is doing with those freaking scissors. Lots of stories are quieter, but no less powerful. Because quiet doesn't mean low stakes. It's just that the stakes are more internal. A great story ties them together, the internal stakes and the external stakes. If you're telling a more literary story, the external stakes might seem low, but the internal stakes are sky high. And stories with obviously high external stakes still have internal stakes too. John McClane's estranged wife is one of the hostages. Dorothy is angry with her family for allowing a wicked woman to take her dog away to be euthanized, which, fair, Auntie M, how dare you? But then realizes how much she loves them and spends all her time in Oz trying to get back to them. And as for Adelaide and her battle with the doppelganger, well, Adelaide's got plenty of internal issues. Let's leave it at that. So if you're struggling with what you feel are low stakes, take a look at both the external and the internal. Make sure you're not just focusing on one, but that your story has both. Tying everything up at the end seems impossible. Okay, I want you to say this out loud. Repeat after me. This is a revision problem, not a first draft problem. Say it. I have never tied up all the loose ends of my plot at the end of my first draft, and I do not know any author who has. So if you're drafting right now, please don't stress about this too much. Now, let's talk about when you're revising. There's going to be some element or elements of your story, Maybe it's a subplot, maybe it's a side character, maybe it's a scene. And now that the draft is complete, you can see that it's just kind of hanging there. It's not resolved. It's not explained. It doesn't have a purpose. Why is that? Well, I can tell you that from my personal experience, here's a mistake I make a lot. In the outlining and drafting and even brainstorming phases of a new book, I get these ideas that I get super attached to. I fall in love with them, and I don't know how or why they fit into this story, but I figure I'll justify them later and I put them in there. And sometimes I do figure out how they fit, but sometimes I don't. And take it from me, you don't want to spend weeks or months or even years rewriting a story over and over and over to try to force this thing in that just doesn't belong. When you're revising or rewriting, be ruthless. This book is not your baby. It's okay to cut stuff. One day you might find the right story for this particular element that you're so in love with, but this story ain't it. Now, if you know that all of your side characters and subplots and scenes do fit into this book and they should tie up at the end, but you're just overwhelmed with trying to figure out how to make that happen, here's my answer to you. Make a book map. A book map is like a post-draft outline that gives you a bird's eye view of your story in its current version. Write a summary of each scene, include the timeline, the setting, the characters present, and their wants and goals, whether or not they achieve them. Then list any new information the reader learns in the scene, what changes and how the scene moves the plot forward, and what, in your opinion, is the point of this scene. This isn't meant to be pretty or voicey. Don't be coy with your language and try to withhold secrets from some imagined reader. You're the only person who's going to read this. Make it blunt. Use bullet points, make lists, make it easy to read at a glance. Having this book map will make drawing these connections and tying up all of those loose ends much less overwhelming. The between beat scenes are boring. Let me say this first. You shouldn't have filler scenes in your book. That's not to say that all between beat scenes are fillers. Obviously, not every scene is going to be a giant action-packed surprise, twist, reveal, turning point. But if you find yourself bored out of your mind when you're writing a scene or reading one of your scenes, then you need to be honest with yourself about what it is doing there in the first place. Second of all, this is also more of a revision problem than a first draft problem. When you're drafting, sometimes the scenes you write, while they may not serve the purpose ultimately of moving your plot forward, they do serve a purpose to reveal something to you as a writer by allowing you to learn something crucial about your story and your characters. For example, let's say you wrote a party scene, and upon finishing your draft, you realize this party is completely irrelevant and just does not belong. But what you got out of it when you first wrote it in your first draft was that it included an interaction between two characters with a particularly complicated dynamic. That's great. That's why you needed to write that scene. So now you can take that interaction out, get rid of the party scene, and part of your job as you revise is to find other scenes where you can showcase this dynamic, maybe even include bits and pieces of that specific interaction. I also think this is another case where creating that book map I was talking about earlier can really help you understand the purpose of those between beat scenes and how they contribute to moving your story forward. Again, just having that bird's eye view of your story can really help you pull back, spot those plot holes, identify places where your character just makes an unrealistic decision, or you're just asking your readers to suspend a little too much disbelief. Also, if you're struggling with writing smooth transitions between scenes, I've got a whole video on that and I'll link it up here in the cards. Writing expected genre tropes while still surprising readers. Romance readers usually expect a happily ever after. Mystery readers want a twist that shocks them while simultaneously making them say, "Oh, of course that's whodunit." Fantasy readers love a good quest after a magical object, but they'll be the first to tell you if you have just written a Lord of the Rings knockoff. Maybe the biggest challenge of writing genre fiction is meeting readers' expectations of beloved tropes that make the genre what it is, while still avoiding cliches and pulling off a surprise or two. So if you're writing in a particular genre and you've been trying really hard to subvert cliches, to write a wholly unique plot that will shatter expectations yet still satisfy those diehard fans of the genre, I have a proposition for you. Maybe it's not your plot that's pissing you off. Maybe it's your characters. Because here's the thing, if you look at those standout stories in every genre, the reason they're so beloved isn't because they defied every trope and changed the game. Most of them deliver on the expected tropes. It's the characters we love. It's the characters we want to follow on this journey. It's their flaws, the way they get themselves into trouble and then get out of it. It's the thing they want that we're desperately rooting for them to get, and the thing they need that we so hope they figure out in time. It's not just the journey they go on. It's how that journey transforms them. That's why we care. Your rom-com, your space opera, your epic fantasy quest might and probably should share a lot of tropes and plot points in common with others in the genre. Don't stress too much about reinventing the plot wheel. Focus on your characters because they are what make your story unique. And when you have truly well-developed characters who are making choices and taking action and that's what drives your plot forward, then your plot is going to feel fresh and original too. The pacing is bleh. Are you tired of hearing me say this is a revision issue? Sick of hearing me talk about book maps? Tough. No first draft is perfectly paced. Fight me. While pacing is definitely something you want to take into consideration while you're outlining and drafting, remind yourself that no matter what, there will be pacing issues to work out in revisions. So again, just don't stress about it too much. And yes, that book map is gonna help a lot. Although here, I've got another option for you. If you don't want to create a book map, if that just doesn't sound fun to you, then all you have to do is print out a version of your manuscript, but make it single-spaced and shrink the font to the smallest possible where you can still read it if you really squint. Then grab some different colored highlighters or pens or whatever and start marking it up. Dialogue, action, introspection, reveals, twists, confrontations. Highlight all of those different types of sections, parts of scenes, and you'll be able to see pretty easily how it's balanced in your book. And you'll also be able to more easily identify the places where you need to do some work in order to achieve the balance that you want. How do I end this monster? Do you really have to tie up every little thing in your story at the end? And how many pages should you spend wrapping things up after the big climactic battle? Honestly, this is really subjective. Some novels have chapters and chapters of aftermath, and some just spend a few scenes or even a few pages or a few paragraphs. Some stories tie everything up in a neat little bow, and others leave things open to the reader's interpretation. So much of this depends on your preference, your style, your genre. I suspect the reason a lot of us struggle with this, me included for sure, is because endings might be the thing critics love to criticize the most. That ending was so predictable. Or it made no sense. Or it was rushed. Or it was too drawn out. Or it needed an epilogue. Or that epilogue sucked. You can't please everyone, and you shouldn't try to. Personally, I love ambiguous endings. A few of my books have been criticized for this, and it doesn't bother me. Because I understand a lot of readers genuinely dislike these ambiguous endings, and that's totally fair. I'm not saying I don't tie up the loose ends and answer most of the questions that I've posed, but as a reader, I love it when I close a book and I can't help but imagine what comes next. I continue the story in my mind. What do the characters go through after this? Those are the more powerful stories for me, the ones that really stick with me. And that's the kind of story I want to write. As a reader, how do you want to feel after finishing your story? What emotion do you want to experience when you close your book? There's a difference between not answering a question because you, as the author, don't actually know, and not answering the question because you hope a reader finds it on her own. I really hope that was helpful, guys. If you thought it was, I would appreciate it if you hit that like button and also maybe share a link to this video with a writer you know who could use some help too. I will see you guys on Friday with another vlog, and until then, keep writing.